There are instances where when you're taking an image, the image is actually being convolved inadvertently by some kind of a kernel. A very good example of this is motion blur. You might be holding your camera, and when you take the picture, you press on your phone or your camera, and there's a little bit of shake. And what really happens is that your ideal image, your sharp image, is being convolved by a motion blur function. And what you want to do then is to remove the effect of this convolution. So thus far, we've been talking about how images can be convolved with filters. But here we have the opposite problem, where you have an image that has been convolved with something, and you want to undo the effect of this convolution. That process is called deconvolution, and it turns out that it's much easier to do in frequency domain using the Fourier transform. So here's the problem of motion blur. You have a scene, f of xy, or the ideal image of the scene, and because of motion blur, you end up convolving this image with the point spread function of the motion blur, which we'll call hxy, and you end up getting a smeared image that looks like this. So you have f convolved with h gives you g, which is the image that you capture. What you'd really like to capture is the image f. But the damage is done. So how do we undo this damage is the question. So the question we're asking is, given a captured image g, which is this one right here, and the point spread function h, this, can we estimate the actual scene f? Now, where does the point spread function come from? Well, there's many ways to do this, but if you look at your phone, your smartphone, for instance, it has something called an inertial measurement unit, an IMU, embedded inside of it, which has accelerometers, it has a gyroscope, and so on. As a result of which, when you move the camera, when you shake the camera during the capture, you can actually estimate the motion of the camera itself and use that to create a point spread function right here. So we'll assume that we have this, and we have this, and we want to find f. How do we do this? Well, we use the Fourier transform to do this. So let's take a look at how this can be done, deconvolution. So let f prime be the image that you're going to recover. We call it f prime and not f because after your recovery process, f prime may not be exactly equal to f. So we'll say that f prime convolved with h is equal to g. So we know what to do here. If we take the Fourier transform, you get f prime uv h uv is equal to g uv. And so it appears that to get f prime, all you need to do is divide g by h. And then, of course, you can take the inverse Fourier transform and you can get f prime. So that sounds pretty straightforward, and let's see how that works. So here you go. You have your original, the image that you captured, and you have your point spread function, which is somehow measured or given to you. And we want to deconvolve the original image with the point spread function to get the result. So what we do is we take the Fourier transform of the image, we take the Fourier transform of the point spread function, and we divide the Fourier transform of the image with that of the point spread function, and we get the Fourier transform of your recovered image. And now if you take the inverse Fourier transform of this, you end up with this image. Works really well. You get a perfect image here, very good reconstruction. If you compare this with this, this is clearly what you want. Now we have a little bit of a problem, and that problem, as is often the case, is noise. So the way noise works here is that you are capturing the image, you shake the camera a little bit, and as a result of which the optical image that's falling on the sensor itself is changing while the sensor is integrating the image. That's where the smearing happens. But then as you read out, remember that from our image sensor lecture, we have photon to electron conversion that's happening at the pixel. But then after that, we have electron to voltage conversion that happens. And there's various sources of noise. There's read noise, quantization noise, thermal noise, and so on and so forth. So this noise essentially gets added to the image after the motion blur takes place. And then you get this noisy motion blurred image. So now let's take a look at this deconvolution process that we just discussed. How well does it work in this particular case? In other words, can we actually afford to ignore noise and just do what we did? So let's take a look at this. So this is your new image, G, except that it has noise in it this time. And this is your PSF. You find the Fourier transform of both, divide them, and you end up with this Fourier transform. And if you take the inverse Fourier transform of this, we hope that we get a reasonable image. But in fact, we get this. We get an image that is overwhelmed by the noise. The noise is amplified. And in fact, the signal that we're looking for, which is f of xy, is drowned by the noise, essentially, overwhelmed by the noise. So let's take a closer look at what's happening here. So we have this simple deconvolution process, which is g divided by h is equal to f prime. And then you take the inverse Fourier transform of that, and you get the recovered image f prime. Now remember that h, which is the Fourier transform of your point spread function of the motion blur, it could be zero for certain frequencies, because after all, it's a low pass filter. So for high frequencies, it could just be zero. And for those frequencies, f is simply not recoverable because you're dividing g by zero. That's point number one. The second thing is that the motion blur filter itself, h, is a low pass filter in the sense that you have smearing of the image going on. That's why it ends up looking blurred, the final image. So it's a low pass filter. And so for high frequencies then, the noise in G we know is high because noise, we saw this before, when you take the Fourier transform of noise, it has high magnitudes for high frequencies. So the noise is high. And at the same time, the filter H is close to zero for some of these frequencies. So you have high noise in G for high frequencies, and H is small for those high frequencies. So you're essentially amplifying the noise substantially, more so than recovering the signal. And that's why you ended up getting the result that you just saw. It was basically salt and pepper noise over the entire image. So we need some kind of noise suppression here during the deconvolution process. So that brings us to Wiener deconvolution. So we're doing exactly the same thing here. You have f prime is equal to g divided by h, except that this time you're going to multiply that with this term here. So we're going to take a look at this term right here. So it's 1 divided by 1 plus nsr divided by h squared. nsr is a noise to signal ratio. It is for any frequency uv, the power of noise divided by the power of the signal itself. So the power of noise divided by power of the signal. Now, admittedly, we don't know the power of the noise for any given frequency. We also don't know the signal itself for that frequency because we are trying to recover it. We don't know these two, but let's pretend for a minute that we do. Then, if the noise is very high for a particular frequency, then this factor here is going to be high. NSR is going to be high, and which means that this entire term is going to be small. And so what you're going to do is attenuate the recovery of the signal for that particular frequency. Or if H happens to be very small right here, because the motion blur kernel itself has very low power for that high frequency, then once again, this factor is going to be very large, which means this factor is going to be very small. And therefore, again, the recovery process is going to be attenuated in that particular case for that frequency. So that's how the Wiener filter works. And it is this entire term here, 1 over h times this factor right here. So what we have established here is that if we know the Fourier transform of the noise And if we know the Fourier transform of the signal that we're looking for, then we can actually develop a very nice filter where the recovery process is very conservative in that it suppresses this amplification of the noise after deconvolution. So as we said earlier, unfortunately for us, we don't know N, which is the Fourier transform of the noise, and we don't know F, which is the Fourier transform of the signal that we're trying to actually recover. And so NSR is unknown to us, but it turns out that if you use a constant value for NSR, we'll call that lambda, often you get deconvolution results that are very nice. So here is an example. Here is the image that we have been dealing with noise in it. Here is the PSF due to motion blur, and you end up recovering this image with an NSR equal to 0.002. Of course, this is not a perfect image. You have some graininess to the image, a little bit of ringing artifacts, but clearly this image is much clearer than the captured image.